Good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure and honor to invite Professor Antonio Colombo to spend 1 hour from his great time to talk to us about history of interventional cardiology and also share with us some rare cases and challenging cases. Prof. Colombo, all people are here excited to listen to you and will be happy to have any question at the end of the session.
Thank you so much. I must confess that in my lifetime I never gave 1 hour lecture, so this is the first time for me. I think I will not bore you too much. So let me start with, first of all, thank you so much for this opportunity and thank you to be here. I always love to be on the east side because it's really more genuine approach to interventional cardiology. I have nothing to disclose. Let's start with some historical slides. Grunzig, who is the father of all our specialty, is interesting that he was an epidemiologist and a statistician before becoming a radiologist. And he was not a cardiologist. So you can do many interesting things without being a cardiologist. His initial work started in his house in the basement where he built the first balloons by himself. So it's another interesting findings. And the most important work was a poster that he presented at the American Heart Association 1976 about balloon angioplasty in a dog model. So not even a formal presentation, just a poster. And he did the first human procedure intraoperatively in the United States with the help of Myler, the one seated on the Vespa below. Sturz is the first person who did angioplasty in the United States, bringing some catheter from Europe in his wallet. So what I take home from these initial experiences is that we should be able to take a constructive lesson from any situation. And the more adverse the situation, the more constructive should be the lesson. These people really faced a tremendous amount of critiques and problems, and many people even ridiculized what they said. One person that in our field young people don't know enough to me is Jeff Hartzler. Jeff Hartzler was an electrophysiologist from Mayo Clinic who lately became interventional cardiologist. We give to Hartzler the merit of complex angioplasty at the time when no stents were used. And he was the initiator of primary angioplasty for acute myocardial infarction. This man, I had the pleasure to know him personally, was a very humble but tremendously skilled person. At that time, an unresolved problem was coronary dissection. I remember that we used to send to emergency surgery about one patient every week. The treatment was prolonged balloon inflation, perfusion balloon with unpredictable result, or emergency bypass surgery. For a limited time, we had directional atherectomy to cut some dissection flap, but was not really very effective and was a real big problem. Then two people, Ulrich Zilbert from Switzerland, Germany, and Gary Rubin from Australia. Gary Rubin initially was a veterinarian, then became a cardiologist. They put together the first experience with coronary stents. Coronary stents were not developed to prevent restenosis. Coronary stent was developed to prevent this problem, acute vessel occlusion following angioplasty. And The stand placement was a saver. And this is a study in 87 by Ulrich Sigbert and the French person Jacques Pouel. Stent saved lives and allowed balloon angioplasty to progress, because at that time was really a problem. I dwell a little bit on my first stent implantation, because I learned a lot at that time. My first stent implantation was on the circumflex in a restenosis following angioplasty. This was done in October 92, and was a very good result. The patient did well, survived many years. He died in 2000 due to cancer. No more angina after the stent procedure. And this is a picture of myself with him. But then, after a few weeks, I did my second case of stent implantation. And this was my first case of stent thrombosis. In January 1990, patient with a stable angina following restenosis of the LAD was a perfect candidate for stenting. I placed a stent in the proximal LAD with a good result. At that time, we implanted stent at 7 atmospheres. The balloon usually broke at 10, so you could not really use high pressure. I did this procedure on Friday. I kept the patient on heparin infusion until Monday. And Monday morning, all of a sudden, while on heparin infusion, he had a stent thrombosis. I took the patient in the cath lab on an emergency. Thanks God I was able to reopen. And I post-dilated the stent with a bigger balloon. And patient did okay, but sustained an anterior MI. At that time, my proctor was Richard Schatz, and I wrote him a letter. There was no email. I wrote him a letter in January and highlight, and I sent him the film. And he answered to me, "Thank you very much for sending the film. I'm vitally interested in every complication so I can continue to learn from every case. If I have to point out a few things," and that's what Richard Schatz wrote to me, "that may have contributed, the omission of persantin. At that time, we gave dual antiplatelet therapy, but with persantin, aspirin and persantin, prior to the procedure. Inflow obstruction and under-dilatation of the stent were factors." So, believe me, in 1990, just with the letter, he pointed out to me that very important, optimal stent implantation, no inflow, no outflow obstruction, and optimal antiplatelet therapy. So these were really very important factors. And then he finally told me, "Don't to be discouraged by one setback. I believe this thrombosis is a rare occurrence," and I continued to work, and I did not get discouraged. So I think it's important to look at the outliers. The patient I had is an outlier, someone who thrombosed. So be strict to accept outliers as exceptions to the rule. The study of outliers is an important source of knowledge leading to better understanding of the real concept. The people that don't stay in the rule are the ones that tell us what's going on. And this is not my lesson, it's a lesson from Professor Attilio Maseri, who is not an interventional cardiologist. But in order to do that, you must be ready to challenge and prove current knowledge, build theories based on intuition, and find empirical support. Sometimes the correct explanation comes later. First you find the solution, then you find the explanation for the solution. Survive to critiques and demolition. And among various attributes, the one I found of most important is persistence. If you have a solid idea, be strong on that idea and try not to give up unless you have good reason to do so. But let's go on why I introduced ticlopidine. This was not a scientific idea, was an intuition. A cardiac surgeon, and this Italian cardiac surgeon told me that there is no question that teclopidine causes a malignant bleeding. I will not operate on any patient who is receiving teclopidine. At that time, an interventional cardiologist from France, Paul Barragan, used to give only teclopidine, no aspirin, after PCI. And he was convinced that if you start teclopidine a few days before PTCA and continue, you will have less dissection, which will occlude. You will still have dissection, but the dissection will not occlude. This was important finding. And then Jonathan Tobis from United States told me how to use intravascular ultrasound. So combining these observations led me to do this study that was published in 95, intracoronary stenting without anticoagulation accomplished with IVUS guidance, and Jonathan Tobis was among the authors. And we did not do a randomized study. I did not want randomized because I had enough occlusion with Coumadin, and I found unethical to give Coumadin if I had the solution. 359 patients, only aspirin and teclopidine and IVUS evaluation. The average balloon pressure at that time was 15 atmosphere. Balloon artery ratio about 1, and we had a surprisingly low thrombosis of 0.9. So this was a real blessing, this finding. And this led me to put together again, nothing new, but this is a Virchow triad. This is tool, is a seat, is like a stent. The stent stays open because you have a good lumen, you have a good runoff, and the blood is sufficiently thin. But you cannot make the blood thin if you have a bad runoff. The stool will fall. All the three legs have to be solid. You cannot make one leg very weak and pretend that the stool stays up because the other two are strong. Without good runoff, even if you implant the stent well, the stent will occlude. And another person in 92, but we forgot at that time, was Ferdinand Kimeny, who proposed radial angioplasty. Remember how many lives we have saved by introducing radial angioplasty. So Ferdinand should be remembered. But then it took another 3 or 4 years before the dual antiplatelet therapy was put into action. In 96, they did a randomized trial, and I was really very sorry to see patients receiving Coumadin when we were already using teclopidine for the prior 2 or 3 years. But these sometimes formal medicine wants this trial no matter what. Even in the United States, it was done in 98, and I was visiting the United States at that time, and to see patients randomized to aspirin alone was a real sad. But look, stents with only aspirin had a thrombosis of 3.6, was very low. So most of the time, even if you give only aspirin, and this was not IVUS guided, the thrombosis rate was not particularly high. But look, with aspirin, teclopidine was only 0.5. So this really opened the field. In 94, we felt that we needed new tools, short and long stent. Finally, we were able to introduce high pressure balloons. Only in 94 they were introduced, and stent dedicated to bifurcational lesion but never survived. We used to cut the palmar shards to have a short stent, and we didn't have long stent. We used to place 3 stents on a long balloon to have a long stent. So these were all things. We used to do this innovative approach to treat bifurcation by placing stents on two balloons to build like a trajus with one stent on one leg and the other on the other leg in 96. So the problem of restenosis was then ameliorated thanks to drug-eluting stents. Drug-eluting stents really took away almost restenosis. We did so many trials with drugs, with ultrasound, with all possible tricks to prevent restenosis until drug-eluting stents came. The problem of stent thrombosis and late thrombosis was minimized thanks to new DS with better polymer and better antiplatelet agents. Later BERT events are a weakness in corner intervention compared to surgical revascularization. We must admit that despite all improvement, we still have more late events compared to bypass surgery, and even optimal stent implantation is not sufficient. Intravascular ultrasound, which was introduced in 95, took a lot of time to gain acceptance, lower the risk of stent thrombosis, and also less intervention, and even in some study use of IVUS lower the risk of death. But remember, and I always say that, intravascular ultrasound does not work by intention to treat. New devices are needed to reach stent optimization. If you do IVUS but you do not optimize the result, is a waste of time. You have to do IVUS and then react appropriately and obtain the result that you expect to achieve. This is an observational study from Korea, and it demonstrated, maybe demonstrated is a strong word, he suggested, because it's not randomized, that using IVUS lowers the mortality, 95 to 85. It's not randomized. But if you look at the biggest randomized studies, the IVUS XPL and the Ultimate, these are relatively old studies, 2015 and 2018, and these a meta-analysis of these studies, angiographic guidance versus IVUS guidance showed lower cardiac death with a significant p-value. So these meta-analysis recently published in 2022, but these two studies were done 5 or 6 years ago and support the observational findings of Dr. Park in Korea. Nevertheless, these studies were done at the time when stent optimization is difficult to achieve. This is a study we did in 2013, only 2 years before the long stent study, and we were able to achieve the criteria met only in 75 lesions out of 150, 81 lesions, despite the use of IVUS, we were not able to achieve the criteria. The two curves are the MLD before IVUS and after IVUS on the left, and on the right, before IVUS and after IVUS, in 85, in 81 lesions, despite whatever you had in 2013, we were not able to achieve IVUS optimization. So, again, the fact that you do IVUS does not mean that you achieve the success if you do not have the devices. Another issue that we did not have at that time, and in 2015 and 18 was the same, we did not have thin strut stents. The stent was about 100 micron, 110. And this is an old study, the ISA stereo, which shows that when you use a thin strut stent in yellow, you have lower restenosis compared to the multilink and compared to another stent BX velocity. So if you have the tools to give you stent optimization with IVUS and better stents with the thin struts that we did not have at that time, your result will be better. So many IVUS guided trials, even the most recent one, did not benefit from very thin strut stents and devices to help obtaining stent optimization, like very high pressure balloon. Now we have CIS balloon that can go to 40 atmospheres. We have scoring balloon. We know how to use cutting balloon and inflate at high pressure, 18, 20 atmosphere. We have orbital atherectomy. We have laser with content. We have lithotripsy. If we repeat those trials, the XT and the Ultimate, with these devices, the result will even be better, because we have, instead of achieving 70% of stent optimization, we may achieve 80 or 85 stent optimization, and this is very important. But after this excursus on the past, and I call this in the past, I want to devote the rest of my lecture on where are we going and what's new on the horizon, because what I just said is all well known and belongs to the history. I love stents. Don't even believe that I am against stenting. Stenting saves lives, and stents allow angioplasty to survive. So stents were implanted and are implanted to prevent occlusion when there is a dissection, and to overcome recoil post-balloon angioplasty. So stents are used to stabilize the lesion. With drug-eluting stents are also used to deliver a drug to allow better healing. So this has to be remembered, because if you have a good result and the lumen is large enough, then you only need the drug to be delivered. The stent becomes something not so important because you already have a good result. So this concept has to be clear. Stent should not be used to treat atherosclerosis. We like to stent, the lesion needs to be covered by stent. Why the lesion needs to be covered by stents? I will change this statement in the bad dissection needs to be covered by stent. But a stent is not a treatment for atherosclerosis. I remember Rick Kuntz, that was a fellow of Donald Baim, one of the pioneers of directional atherectomy, used to propose that a metastent should be implanted throughout the proximal LAD to make the LAD protected like a mammary. But no, the idea to place a stent to treat atherosclerosis is a naive idea and does not have any scientific support. So when we say we need to cover the lesion, I don't understand what does it mean. We need to cover the dissection has a meaning, but to cover the lesion is a different story. So keep in mind this. Why most operators stent every lesion to be treated? Among many reasons, the most important is to prevent sudden closure when the result is not stent-like. And as I said yesterday, I would like to reintroduce, because this concept was introduced by a guy named Andreas Grunzig, who utilized the PDPA in the early time, to give security about the risk of sudden closure. PDPA interrogates lesion treated with limited impact on the distal bed. Why we need this? Because in some situation, if we can avoid to implant a stent, and if we are able to achieve a good result without a stent and give a drug to the wall without a stent, maybe, I say maybe, there is an advantage. But at least it's an interesting working hypothesis. Let me show you a case. This is a standard gentleman, relatively young, with a good ejection fraction, treated in the past. Now he comes to our attention with a long, diffusely diseased LAD lesion. You know, if you look at the ischemia trial, this patient can be left alone because you can give medical therapy. In many hospitals, I would see this LAD lesion treated with two long stents. I'm not particularly enthusiastic. I think even if the long stents are well implanted, if you follow this patient for 10 years, after a while, they develop atherosclerosis inside the stent. Maybe you could say they would have developed atherosclerosis no matter what. But I don't know. But I think I'm not attracted by the idea to implant two or three 38 millimeter long stents in this LAD. What we did OCT to evaluate the vessel. The vessel is small, distally is a little bit bigger than 1 square millimeter, proximally is 4 square millimeters. So it's this is a confirmation of what we already know, long diffuse disease involving even the diagonal. We treated the diagonal with balloon angioplasty. We did DFR. After balloon angioplasty was 86, so 86 of DFR is very acceptable for this vessel. Then we did balloon, drug-coated balloon, 2.540 on the diagonal, and no stent implanted with a good result. But then we addressed the LAD. We did multiple dilatation with a semi-compliant balloon, 3 millimeter, 2.5 distally. We did we repeated the OCT. There is some dissection, but the lumen is preserved. But the most important is that we measure DFR, and the DFR is now 0.92, and the PDPA is 1. So means that in the distal part of the LAD, you have the same pressure than in the aorta, which is very rewarding. And that's the reason why we did drug-coated balloon. We used magic touch in two or three positions. And this is the final result. It's not a stent-like result, but it's a nice lumen. You have not a single foreign body. And this was done two years ago, and the patient is doing well. This is another example. Is an LAD with a more advanced disease, proximal disease, diffuse disease, distally. We did the pre-dilatation lesion preparation as usual. The balloon did not expand despite high pressure. We did IVUS, which showed that there was a concentrated calcium. So we used lithotripsy to better expand the balloon, nothing new. Then we used cutting balloon. And finally, we used non-compliant high-pressure balloon. And this is the result after we implanted the stent proximally. Here we implanted few years ago a bioresorbable stent, short, 24 millimeter, but you could implant a metal stent. But you see there is a lot of dissection distally. So the case is not finished. What can you do? The most standard approach is to implant a 40 millimeter stent 2.5, maybe post-dilate the stent proximally 3.0 and 2.5 distally. We measure PDPA, was 86, 84, the FFR was 77, obviously abnormal, but you don't really need this measurement because it's so clear. But then we did additional balloon dilatations without implanting the stent. The dissections are still there, but the PDPA now is 91 if you go distally, and the FFR is 87. We waited a few minutes, and the stable number stayed stable, did not deteriorate. As a matter of fact, very frequently they get better. So these gave us confidence to use a drug-coated balloon, two long drug-coated balloon. So this is a hybrid approach, a stent proximal in a big vessel, but instead of using a full metal jacket, we used different technology. So we don't throw away the stent. We integrate old knowledge with new knowledge, and we also put into the pot a measurement of the pressure gradient to give us security. And look at the one-year result. I'm collecting cases. I hope next year I will have real data with follow-up result. But this result is very rewarding. If you see the vessel who maintained all the curvature, the side branches are all there. There is no foreign body. It's really, I like that. Look at this circumflex. This is a, you can stand, but it's a lot of work. You have to, we did pre-dilatation. There is a, some dissection, but the lumen is well confirmed. We measure pressure gradient was very low. Then we did the DCB. Look at the one-year result. The dissection healed. It's even better than the final result. And we have several of these cases. We are collecting. Look at this bifurcation. Here seems there is the left main, but the catheter is not well engaged. But the target lesion is the bifurcation of the LED diagonal. These 3 or 4 years ago, I would have no refrain to place two stents. The diagonal is very long. It's a big diagonal. You need a mini crush or culotte. We predilated both with the idea to implant maybe one stent, but after the predilatation, the result was, we had dissection, but the result was very good with PDPA in the LED, which was 1 and 91 distal in the diagonal. So we stayed away and we didn't even implant a stent. This was a real, and we are collecting data like this, but not only the result angiographically, but the PDPA is giving us reassurance. This is a more extreme case. I saw this case yesterday for people that are not here. It's a quadrifurcation with a stent in the proximal LED, but disease progression proximally. The plan was to implant a stent from the left main to the LED, but after predilatation and kissing, the result was so good, then we said, why we implant a stent? We waited 10 minutes, there was no recoil, and the result was stable. We used the drug-coated balloon. We did the kissing inflation with the drug-coated balloon with a good result. This patient was done about 5 or 6 months ago. We are waiting for a longer follow-up, and then we will have the outcome on the long term. Even in acute MI, I believe there is a role. I met yesterday an interventional, I think, from Saudi Arabia or from this area, who has a large experience about using drug-coated balloon in acute MI. And in some setting, a stent is not ideal. This is an old study where published in JACC, first author Greg Stone, where even if there is no p-values, they had 2 deaths in the stent group, 0 in the PTCA in acute MI, with 4 infarction and 0. So in some situations, you may have to avoid stenting. I don't say that you should not stent acute MI, please. But I think to have in mind an alternative treatment in some patient may be of value. So in some setting, stenting ST elevation MI may not be the optimal solution. Let me give you some data, because I gave you so far only anecdotal experience. And we have a small paper in print. It will be printed maybe in 2 or 3 weeks in JACC Cardiovascular Intervention. I am the senior author. And we treated 190 lesions in 86 patients. Now the numbers are 2 times more. This paper underwent revision, so was presented about 1 year ago, and finally published now. We had lesion preparation in 103. One patient at the very beginning had shifted to stenting. Following lesion preparation, 20 lesions had a PDPA less than 90, and 88 following lesion preparation had a PDPA more than 90. All these 83 underwent DCB. The 20 lesions with a suboptimal PDPA less than 90 underwent or focal stenting focal stenting and DCB. Focal PDPA stayed below 90 despite some additional dilatation, and then we implanted a DS. In some other lesions, which were on 14, we used an hybrid strategy. We implanted a stent proximally and the DCB distally. So finally, out of these 104 lesions, 6 underwent what you call extensive stenting, 20 underwent an hybrid procedure, and 79 underwent only DCB. And these are all complex lesions. They are not short lesions. 80% of the lesions were on the LAD. A cutting balloon was used in 25, rotablator in 5.8, shockwave 5.8. So it's really a complex procedure. Imaging was used in 62. And this is the pressure gradient, the baseline after predilatation and after the balloon, eluting balloon. And these are the events at more or less 1 year. Very interesting, we have 0 definite stent thrombosis. Now the number of lesions are 2 times more, and the number of patients as well are close to 200. And the vessel thrombosis is still 0. We have a target lesion failure at 12 months of 5%, which is very acceptable, and we have no cardiac death. So I believe these data are encouraging. Again, there is a usage of stent, but the stents are used only when the result is not acceptable or when you prefer to use an hybrid approach. So the preliminary conclusion about DCB, DCB are effective for treatment of in-stent restenosis. DCB can be used to treat small vessels, and we all know these, but utilizing an appropriate strategy, DCB can be utilized to treat a long lesion, limiting the stent length even in large vessels. We need the studies, we need the data to support this last statement, but I believe this is interesting. Let's devote another 2 or 3 minutes. I may not be able to speak to you for an hour, so we leave some room for questions. What about bioresorbable scaffold? I believe bioresorbable scaffold needs to come back. Why? Because I think positive vessel remodeling and appearance of pulsatile flow is an interesting findings when you implant bioresorbable scaffold. This is something we published many years ago, 2015. Look at this diffuse disease circumflex, a subtotal occlusion of the distal circumflex. This patient has a CABG on the LAD. We implanted the 3 bioresorbable scaffolds. These are the old Abbott absorb very thick struts devices. We implanted 3 of them. But what is interesting is what you see on the right. The index procedure in 2 and 1, you see the acute result. But look 3 years after, you will see the measurements in a second, but you don't really need to measure. It's obvious that 2' is bigger than 2O and 1 prime. As a matter of fact, if you measure the area, the mean lumen after the procedure is 4.9, and the mean lumen 3 years after is 7.3. If you implant a meta stent, this achievement is impossible. So the only way to achieve this late enlargement can only be achieved if you implant a bioresorbable scaffold or if you implant, if you use a a drug-coated balloon. So I think if we need to make angioplasty progress in the new generation area, we need to slowly move away from implanting metal device. So this is my last slides and the conclusions. Stent thrombosis has almost been conquered, almost, but I would say conquered. Stent restenosis is low. Nevertheless, PCI trial demonstrate inferior result compared to CABG. Better lesion preparation and stenting with imaging guidance may help, but I'm not sure that this will totally resolve the problem. I have personal concerns about the long-term outcome of long stents. If you can limit stent length, I believe is useful. Stents do not prevent disease progression, and we need to explore alternatives to stenting. Stents are not the treatment for atherosclerosis. There are good reasons to justify a comeback of bioresorbable scaffold. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Prof. Colombo. It was really the fastest 15 minutes to watch you presenting great cases and great history. And definitely would like to open the floor for any question from the audience. Dr. Abdel Shahab will start with then Dr.
Excellent talk, Dr. Colombo. I'm here, as a panelist. Abdel Shahab. Thank you very much for taking through this journey. I just want to have 2 comments. First, it's great to see a person who been part of the history, and we've seen that in terms of DAPT, stenting, imaging, and now also you told us to challenge the current ideas. I think that's what we should do as a, you know, because medicine is not a dogma, it's probabilities. So that has made us to go for better for the patient in terms of DCBs or scaffolding. My question to you, so who's been your most influential person in your life, and what you do outside your practice, your hobbies?
What I do outside my practice, I like to read, I like music, I like to ski, and honestly, I will not feel unhappy if tomorrow I have to stop doing interventional cardiology.
Dr. Adel.
Thank you for the excellent talk. I just want to go back to the old days when you used to undersize the balloons and we are satisfied with minor dissections, and even dissections at that time was a criteria of success. You should have some kind of dissection. We were raised about that. What made this progress of restenosis low with only balloons. Was it the proper sizing of the balloons or the drug-coated balloon? What do you think? If there will be something comparing drug-eluting balloon with only balloon, but proper sizing and proper lesion preparation, what do you think?
But I don't think that we can progress without stents. Stents are essential because when you do pre-dilatation of a lesion, is a little bit, yesterday someone asked me, how do you know if you're going to have a dissection or not? And if the dissection is going to be bad? I don't know. I still, after so many years, I don't know. I can guess a little bit, but sometimes I'm surprised. So I think my concept is that stents should not be the standard way to do PCI, because now we have tools to deliver the drug without putting a foreign body. But I think stents are essential, because in some lesions, the only way to dilate the lesion is to create a dissection, and some dissection, not all of them, but maybe 20%, 10% are not stable, and is better to stent. But now I believe we have some tools, IVUS, maybe OCT. I'm a little bit afraid of OCT with dissection, because the fact that you have to inject dye or water, whatever, to do OCT, the injection may extend the dissection. So I don't like to inject too much when I have a dissection. So that's the reason why I prefer IVUS or pressure gradient. But now I think we have the tools to evaluate a dissection and to make a more intelligent decision.
Dr. Mohamed Kurdi.
First of all, thanks for the nice lecture, Professor Colombo. It's a great talk, and for me it was like listening to one of these orchestra of music that you'll enjoy all the day. So it was very quick and very elegant. Thank you very much. I have a question for you, which is, what do you think went wrong with the scaffold, from your opinion, and why the scaffold is not really has been taken over the stent yet? Now, the second thing, it's a comment actually. I've been doing what you're talking about for the last 10 years, using DCBs with hybrid stenting only in certain areas. And in the Middle East with the diffuse disease, I was forced to do this because we have lots of distal disease. We have not a great surgical outcome, sorry for our surgeons. We had to do it because patients were symptomatic. So I'm still using a long drug-coated balloon on the mid and distal vessels, where I only stent the proximal. I had some occasions where I was actually maybe a little bit having more courage and doing osteal lesions with DCB alone. But what I learned in my case is that I respect the vessel in a way that I actually go inflation very slowly and I deflate very slowly, minimizing any risk of dissection. And I go by 1-to-1 size, and I try to be very careful with my pressure going up and pressure going down. And I will kick my fellow out if he actually switch off quickly and deflate rapidly, because that's for me is not the way I do it. So I do a very slow inflation and a very slow deflation on lesion preparation as well as on the DCB. Thank you for the talk.
Okay, thank you for the question about bioresorbable scaffold. I think what was went wrong with Absorb is that this device was not ready for such big trials against state-of-the-art metastent, 140 microns. In addition, there was this initial concern about utilizing high pressure, post-dilatation. So The device was an experimental device. They should have waited. They should have done registries. We have used over 400 absorb with IVUS guided high pressure, 20 atmospheres with excellent results. So, but the device was too thick, was not ready to be put in the arena against a giant like science. Regarding the lesion, regarding the long diffuse disease, I think I went to India in August, and with diffuse disease, it's very important to have devices like drug-coated balloon instead of super long stents. Regarding the lesion preparation, I've been asked many times, should you be more gentle to prepare the lesion? I still don't know, honestly. I'm not so sure that inflating slowly, it helps. I think it's a mental idea, but when you go to 18 atmospheres, if you go slowly or so quickly, you go to 18. So, I don't know. So, you may be right. I don't say that you are wrong, but still we need more data. Simon Ecclenshaw, which is an interventionist from UK, has exactly the same idea as you, to go to low, to pressure slowly, to be more gentle. Bruno Scheller is a little bit different, so we still don't have a good idea. So we have to work, generate data, and find out what's wrong.
Great. Dr. Hadi?
Yeah. Thanks to the organizers and thanks to Colombo for the historical perspective. Very important to appreciate the challenges faced our early frontiers, appreciate what we have today and learn for the future. So what you've given is the philosophy, maturity and wisdom of intervention. This is the best part of the world to deliver this because they do appreciate history. And the wise man or the wisdom we're talking about is called the Hakim, and he is the other name for doctor. You've described a lot of trials and a lot of practice and a lot of success, but we learn from failure more than we learn from success. When were you most disappointed in your journey of interventional cardiologist? And how did you get the resilience to overcome and move forward and show us where we are today?
I was most disappointed of the cases of stent thrombosis associated with bleeding from the groin. I had patients relatively young die in front of me with femoral artery bleeding and at the same time stent occluded. And this is a very bad experience, especially if the procedure was done electively, go back in the room of the patient and talk to his wife and son or children. And this is very, very sad. So these are the most disappointing things. Also, when you break a vessel because you go to high pressure, try to overcome the calcium, the vessel is broken, the cover stent cannot get delivered. So these are, when a patient dies, it's a very bad experience, especially if the procedure is done electively. We cannot afford any more major complication in elective patients. We can afford in acute MI, the patient comes with CPR, it's okay. It's not okay, but you know, it's already dead when he came. But I cannot accept a patient who comes to the hospital with a suitcase and he goes home in a suitcase. This is not acceptable. I got the strength to continue because I like to resolve problems. I love persistence. I always tell my fellow that it's better to be persistent than intelligent.
Great. Good wisdom, Dr. Yes. Hani.
Thank you very much, Dr. Colombo. I'm Hani Raghi from Cairo. And I do repeat what everybody said, that if it wasn't for your work, probably none of us would have been in this room today. I mean, at some point, stenting was going to disappear, and your work has contributed. My question, which is I think your biggest contribution to, my personal opinion, that your biggest contribution to angioplasty is that the fact that you have managed to teach the world that you can have, you simplify the procedure. So for instance, in Pakistan, in India, in Egypt, in many countries of Africa, a young doctor is gonna go in at 3 o'clock in the morning and do a primary PCI for a STEMI patient in less than half an hour, using high pressure, using what you have taught. They don't have IVUS, they don't have DP over DT, and DP or DA, and they, you know, lives are saved every day on this planet thanks to the fact that you've actually simplified the procedure, but not too simple, it's simple and safe. So primary PCI is still a life-saving procedure for thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people every day in very poor countries. And I just got worried when you gave a message now that this might not be the way to go, because there are hundreds, maybe thousands of cath labs in the world which are following very good procedures and saving lives every day, which might suddenly be told that they have to do DP over DA and not stent primary PCI, which is not feasible for all those countries I just mentioned. So, you know, I hope that your message, also gives some reassurance to those who are not going to have this technology in the near future, that primary PCI with stents is here to stay, and so, it is the most important life-saving procedure in interventional cardiology. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I got your message. Your message is very clear. I'm not changing the idea. What you said is absolutely right. But in order to make progress, sometimes you have to make some changes. Follow the most important path, but learn that in some situation, the path is not ideal. So, you don't need PDPA. If in acute MI you do predilatation and the result is excellent, no dissection, super result, finish. You don't even need a stent. You don't need a post dilate. It's done. You maybe use a drug coated balloon if you have it. So if you have a dissection and you don't PDPA, place a stent. I'm not against stenting. If you don't have the tool to measure, you place a stent. But my message is that if you have a patient with a spontaneous dissection, maybe it's better not to stent if you have a good result like the cases that was presented yesterday. So I just throw some small changes, but I don't leave my main route. That is what you said.
Thank you.
Great. Last two questions, Dr. Sobhi.
Thank you, Antonio. We are from the generation who started the PTCA without stenting. And I remember that we're doing just undersized in order to prevent dissection. We don't have an emergency cavage. Well, also perfusion balloon. I need your opinion why the DCP is delayed. It's been since 10 years. And it's only in an instant restenosis. Even it's not class 1A. It's class 2B. So even in my practice and also all our colleagues, when you found instant restenosis and doing pre-dilatation, they are afraid to put only DCP, they only put stent, instant stent. So do you think that we need more data for DCP in general? Or do you think that we don't know the actual benefit of DCP? What be the future for this DCP?
But I obviously we need more data. First of all, DCP are too expensive. I mean, DCB cost 2 times the price of a stent. That was in Italy. And in Italy, DCB are not even reimbursed. So It's crazy. If you place a stent, you get reimbursement, and you even the hospital makes a profit. If you use a DCB, you not only don't make a profit, but you lose money. So this is a whole field that needs to grow economically, because we need some sustainability, because you cannot do something and waste money. And you need data. So what you said takes time, but I think DCB is a way to deliver an anti-proliferative drug without placing a scaffold when a scaffold is not needed, period.
Great, last question.
Thanks for the talk.
But I'm not a particularly fan of DCB. If you tell me, would you take away stents or DCB, I take away DCB, of course. Stents save lives, DCB, no.
Thanks for the talk, I'm Dr. Mahmoud. My question is regarding the handling of the dissection. How to manage the dissection before the drug-coated balloon. For type A and type B, I know we can just leave it. So we can use the drug-coated balloon normally and the results should be fine. So what do you do for advanced dissection like type C, type D? Should you trust the physiology? Should you do imaging? Should you wait and observe? If I have a dissection, advanced, like spiral dissection, I'm willing to do a drug-coated balloon. Is it safe from your practice?
How to manage a dissection? First of all, you have to decide if you really want to manage. The most practical way to manage the dissection is to stent. But if you really want to manage the dissection, I would suggest that the best approach is to use long balloons. Do a long inflation, but extending the balloon at not a high pressure outside the dissection area. Usage of long balloons help to stabilize some dissections. But, you know, we enter into the field of art, personal feelings. This is not science.
So I mean, if it's improving by the long inflation of the long balloon, I can use a drug-coated balloon safely after that? You think so?
Long inflations and long balloons. The balloon has to be a little bit outside the dissection area.
Okay.
And even if for the predilatation, predilating with the long balloon is usually better, because still creates a dissection, but the dissection is more stable.
Then we can apply the drug-coated balloon after that, right? And afterwards, we can use a drug-coated balloon on top.
Yeah, and after you can use the drug-coated balloon.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have to be able to stand beside you. Okay, thank you very much, Prof. Colombo. We cannot thank you enough. It was even a very quick 1 hour, and we need more time to enjoy your presentation. And it's an honor for us in the GIS to have you with us. And you are the only one in the world that have been recognized and known by everybody in cath lab in this planet. GIS are honored and happy to have you, and we're looking forward to more collaboration with you. We'd like you kindly to come here. We prepare for you a trophy with the stent that you have open, so you can change it to DCB at any time.